like to start with a quick warning. Has any of you seen the talk earlier today from Chris about containers? Like half the room? Well, there's a lot of overlap. There's a lot of overlap between the two talks, and there's a talk right now about static code analysis. So if you're interested, and you know, by all means, go ahead. Really? Nobody's gonna go? Oh, got one. That's good. I'd rather have people, you know, get something out of this session. Does anybody use Docker in their day-to-day? Almost everyone. Might not learn a lot here. My goal is kind of to get everyone to get out and so I can just go for a nap or something. All right, we've got two. All right. Does anyone? All right. No, I just wanted to be honest with you guys, and this is kind of so I'm gonna go do a lot of overlap with Chris's talk. Unfortunately, this is not a talk that was originally part of the schedule, so that happens sometimes. So I'd rather you people at least be aware of that, and if there's something that you something else that you want to attend, by all means, do so. Thank you for staying, for those who stayed. Not sure if I should thank you, because that, you know, ruins my nap, but all right. So, containers. Containers have been around for a few years now. By now, probably all of you have at least heard of Docker. If you're here, I kind of assume that you don't use it daily. That's kind of where I start from. So everybody says that those containers are wonderful. They'll solve all the problem, but yet. I didn't use it until very recently. And why is that? Well, for me, it was kind of a little bit too complex. Like, there's this learning curve that I didn't really want to worry about, and I just didn't really see the benefits. I'm sure I heard that it fixes the whole works on my machine syndrome and those type of thing, but I work alone most of the time. So what's the point, right? But until I found some actual real case scenarios and I saw some really practical examples, it didn't make any sense to me. So this is kind of what I want to show you today. Just a few very practical examples. How can you use containers just to make your development life a little bit easier, your software developer life a little bit easier? So that's kind of what I'm going to go through. So I'm going to show you some practical examples and how to use Dockers in those cases. Now, most of this will be done in the command line, because that's where Docker lives. So let's switch already to our terminal. And start from here instead. So containers for software developers. Didn't have enough room for software, but containers for developers, perfect. You know, I figure I stay in themes. If we're going to spend our time in the terminal, might as well start from here. So hi, I'm Joel. You might not recognize me there, but that's an old picture, so don't worry. That's why. I work as a developer advocate for Red Hat OpenShift, which is a Kubernetes distribution made by Red Hat. If you want to talk about it, I'd be more than happy. I am based in Canada, in Ottawa. You've heard that this morning, anyways. And I love Twitter. So Joel with two underscores, Lord. Oh, I have stickers. I forgot to take them out, but I'll put them out here somewhere. You might have seen them on Twitter if you follow PHP UK. I've got stickers about password hygiene and stuff like that. So come and grab some on your way out. Let's talk about containers. So why should you use containers? Well, the main reason that people will tell you is usually that it's the same environment as your production environment. Because you're using a container, everything is packaged as one, so basically you have the exact same environment from one setup to the other. So it makes it a lot easier to deploy different things. But it can also be very useful for a lot of different things. Onboarding, for example, is a great use case for containers. If you have a new member joining your team, the first few days, he'll have to spend installing a LAMP stack on his machine, and then he won't be running the same version of PHP as you do, because he just installed it, and you installed it 2 years ago, and you have all those differences between your environments. So So containers can be very useful for that. If you have a containerized environment, then they can just do a Docker pull, and they're ready to go, and they can actually start on day one. It's also very, very, very useful for open source contributions. I strongly believe in open source, and well, I work at Red Hat, yeah. And it can be very, very valuable there. You've probably experienced that at one point in your career so far, where you're using this open source library, there's a tiny little thing that bugs you, so you want to go inside the source code and change that. So you do a Git clone, now you have the source code, but you don't know where to start, you don't have anything set up, you need to set up a database in order to connect with all that stuff, and it's just, it takes forever, and it's kind of a pain to just do that little tiny change that you want to do. So if you containerize your environment, then people that want to contribute to your project can actually do a Docker pull, and they have all the environments set up for them. They can just try that little change, see if it works, and then push everything back. So it makes it very, very, very easy for people to contribute to your project. Joined In is one of those projects, an open source project, the one that you're using to rate the speakers today, where basically you can just download everything, run it in a containerized environment, and you're ready to go very, very easily, and you can do PRs right there. It's also very, very useful for testing, especially if you have a team of QA people doing manual testing. In this case, there's no more fighting over this works on my machine or not. You can actually ship everything. They run the exact same thing, the exact same environment, the exact same setup as you do. So there's no more arguing, almost. But it won't solve all the problems that you might have. It won't work. It won't really help you with all networking, DNS routing. There's a little bit of tweaking that you'll need to do. There are some tools that can help you with that. But really, what you would need if you want to go into those is to look into Kubernetes. Same thing with scaling. Using containers themselves won't help with scaling. So that would be the job of Kubernetes, for example. By the way, there's also a tutorial about Kubernetes right now, you know, if you want to leave. But Kubernetes will be there to help you with the scaling. So what is a container exactly? Container is a standard unit of software that packages up code, all of its dependencies, so the application runs quickly and reliably from one computing environment to the other. So really, it takes everything that you need to run your software, packages all of that, and that's the unit that you'll be shipping. So it's a lightweight, standalone, executable package of software that includes everything needed to run in an application. So it includes your code, your runtimes, your system tools, system libraries, and all the settings that you need to run this application. So that's why if you ship everything to your QA team, they'll be running the exact same code, runtime, system tools, system libraries, and settings as you are. It's also a disposable unit. So once your container is done doing whatever it was doing, it'll just destroy itself. And that's kind of part of the raison d'être of a container. It'll just start, do something, and then die, gracefully die, and destroy everything that it created. So it will destroy all the extra files that it created. It will also destroy any data that you've entered in a database. So it can be very useful for testing, for example, automated testing. So you can inject a bunch of crap in your database, and it doesn't matter because you're going to destroy everything. And next time you're going to start your testing, you're going to start with a fresh new database again. So it can be very useful for that, but it's also something that you need to keep in mind. So if you actually want to keep some of that data, you have to make sure that you map to a volume and make sure that that data is stored somewhere outside of the container. All right. So it's just like a VM, right? It works the same way. It's kind of containerized, works in its own bubble. Nope, not the same. I won't go into too much of the details of how a container actually works, mainly because it was explained this morning. So there's a great talk at 10 a.m. this morning if you want to learn more about that. But basically, the way we will look at our architecture when we have a VM is that you have your infrastructure that runs different things, and you have an operating system that will run on your infrastructure. So you have an operating system running on your machine, a Mac OS on my machine, for example, and then you have a hypervisor. I'm not sure what a hypervisor is, but the name is so cool that I had to put it back there. I think it does something with sharing the resources and something like that. But then it shares the different resources on your machine to all the different VMs that are running on your machine. So it shares the memory and so on with all those VMs. Now, each VM also has its own operating system and is only aware of what's going on in this VM and is only aware of the resources that has been allocated to that specific VM. So you can have multiple VMs running on a single machine, on a single operating system, but you can already see that there's a lot of overhead. And if you need to start a VM, well, it'll take a few seconds in order to boot that extra operating system. Now, containers are a little bit different in the sense that they run directly on your as part of your operating system if you're running Linux, or you will use a tool like Docker that will act as a daemon. So you have your infrastructure, you have your operating system, and then this tiny layer of Docker, in this case, and it will just spin up new processes running your application. When you're running everything directly on Linux, you don't even have this layer here, so you can use a tool like Podman that will directly allocate the resources to your processes, and it makes it much, 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 much faster than a VM. I've been talking about containers. Where does Docker fit in there? Docker is just one of the various tools to run containers. It's the one that most developers are familiar with. Unless you're actually using Linux, you might have heard of Podman. But Docker is just one tool to run containers. Containers all or should all be using the OCI, which is the Open Container Initiative standard. So they should all be using the same type of structure. So in theory, you can use any tool to run those containers. So Podman is the alternative for Linux. All right, so that's for containers. That's kind of what it is in a nutshell. I have a few links at the end. There's a great resource that explains really in detail how they work if you're interested in the internals. But let's look at how to use them in practice. So I know we're at a PHP conference, but I do a lot more JavaScript nowadays. But I did a lot of PHP up until a few years ago. One of my colleagues knows that, and he once came to me and was like, hey, you know, I'm running into this issue with my PHP code. I can't figure it out. Can you take a look at it? And I was like, well, I don't have PHP or Apache or anything really installed on this machine. And really, I didn't want to install anything because, like I said, it's been a few years since I did some PHP, but I still have nightmares about installing MAMP on my laptop. So really, I didn't want to go through that hassle. But then I remembered, oh yeah, like I've heard about containers. And that was one of the first times that I actually used a container to help with an actual problem that I had. So here we have a terminal inside a terminal that I built, because why not? And it's the first time I'm using it on this machine, so I'm not sure if it's actually going to work, but let's see. So what I did in that case, well, of course, I needed to, you know, just start an Apache server and install like Apache and PHP and all that stuff. Well, I've heard that you can use Docker run, and then we'll run something in detached mode, and you can just use an image like Apache 7.1, and that's it. My server started. So I was a little bit curious, and then we can do a curl localhost. Well, okay, so it doesn't quite work. Connection is refused on port 80. That's because you cannot run something on port 80 on your machine. But I have a server up and running already. I'll show it in more details in a few minutes so that you actually believe me and you see that it's a real server. But that's all you need. You just need to do a Docker run and you've got a server running. Let's just stop this one. Okay, so Docker run is the first command that you'll want to use, and you just give it the name of an image. I've used PHP 7.1 Apache in this case, so there's a bunch of different images that are already pre-built for you. Take a look at hub.docker.com. Everything is there. There's a lot of, and look for the official images. That's very important, and you'll see them there. They're very clearly marked as being the official image. And typically, they have the name of the image, and then a colon, and a version number. And sometimes there's a dash with a variant. So you can have the PHP, just a PHP tool. You can have the PHP for CLI. You can have, I think there's a PHP and something with Nginx, or the PHP that runs with Apache. So this is why I've used that one. So PHP, I wanted 7.1, and I wanted to include the whole Apache server with it. Now, I've shown you that it didn't work on port 80, so I need to actually map this into a different port on my machine. So I'll use the -p flag here, and I'll tell Docker to map the port 8080 on my machine to the port 80 inside the container. So Apache runs on port 80, and I'll be able to access that port 80 through a tunnel on the port 8080 on my machine. So now we have an Apache server, it runs, but it doesn't serve any files, right? So what we'll do is that we'll mount a volume. So we can use the -v option, and -v will actually mount a volume, so we'll tell it, well, use the current working directory on my machine, so the one from which I've started or this command, and map this to /var/www/html inside the container. So it will actually overwrite that directory inside the container with whatever I have in this folder. So now that I have all of this, I have this big command, and I can pretty much run an Apache server that will run, and it will be pre-configured with PHP, will serve the files from my current directory, and it will map all of this to port 8080 so I can actually use it. There's a few other useful flags that you might want to use with a Docker run. -d will let you run a Docker container in detached mode. If you don't run it in detached mode, you'll see all the logs being printed in real time. --rm is kind of a useful flag just to make sure that everything is removed once once the container is stopped, or else it'll just start leaving a bunch of junk. That's one thing that you have to be aware of when you're using Docker. You will at some point run out of disk space. That never happened to me before, but it leaves a bunch of different cache images and stuff on your machine, so you have to be careful about that. So using --rm at least ensures that it removes that container once it's stopped. You can also use --name, which is very useful if you're using script, so that you can actually give a name to your container and you'll be able to access that container in the future. So to start my container, I now have this command, but we've seen each part one at a time, so it shouldn't be too scary anymore. So we've got our Docker run. We will run this in detached mode. We will make sure that we remove that container once it's done its execution. We'll give it a name, so we'll call it myphp. We will map a folder on our machine, and then we will map a port. And the image that we actually want to run is php 7.1 Apache. And now I know this one will crash, so I'm actually going to use another one. I'll stop bragging about my terminal and terminal. Docker, run. What did I say? Detached mode. Make sure that we remove it afterwards. We'll give it a name. And we will map current folder, samples PHP. And we need to map the port. And we will run PHP 7.1 Apache. There you go. So my server is started once again. So now I can actually curl localhost 8080. And I get my file that are served. So that's all I need, really. Well, it's a long command. It's a lot of things that you need to remember by heart. But there's a lot of cheat sheets to help you out there. But that's all you need to actually set up an Apache server. So it's a lot simpler than actually going on and doing the whole install process. And now everything is mapped on my local file system. So if I actually go and change a file here, I believe it's the index file, and let's just add something. And we do a curl again, then you see the extra something that I've just added right there. So it's really mapped on my local folder. So now I can actually work inside my local file system. I can do the changes in my file and test everything locally, so I don't have to install all that system, or even worse, try to push that into a server to see if it actually works. So that was one of my first use cases, and I thought that was very, very interesting, and it definitely made my life a lot easier. And that's when I started digging a little bit more into Docker and try to see how I could use it. So you can also run a PHP command line tools or command line commands. So we will use the same type of thing here. So we'll have a Docker run. We'll map a local folder on our machine into the slash app folder of our container. Our container is Linux-based, so you'll have to keep that in mind when you give commands to your containers. So I'm using slash app here. And I'm going to use PHP 7.1. I won't be using the Apache version this time, because I actually just want to run this command. So I'll actually run PHP and slash app slash cli.php, and it'll just output me whatever result that I get from that file. You can also specify a working directory, and then it'll already be in slash app in this case, because I've specified the W, and you can just call PHP CLI. So that last part is really the command that you want to execute inside your container after it started. So let's take a look at this. I don't trust this thing anymore. So Docker run. And we'll use PHP 7.1. No, need to mount a volume. And then we'll use PHP 7.1, not 8, 7.1. PHP slash app slash CLI. Does that work? There you go. So that simple script will just count the number of files and output whatever it is. I like to use PHP for CLI stuff every now and then just to script different things. I hate Bash. I shouldn't say that. Red Hat is gonna fire me. But I just don't like Bash. It's like, I don't like the structure. So PHP is actually very useful if you want to do command line stuff. So that's one example. Now that's interesting. So one thing that I've learned while I was here. So I went to this talk yesterday. Did anyone attend Derek's talk about PHP 7.4.3? New features? All right. That's a picture that I took during his talk. It's a little bit small here, but one of the feature, you can barely see it. But one of the features that was added inside PHP 7.4.3 is that it gives you a warning when you're using or doing a bad use on precedence of operators. Let me just. You've got to bear with me. I'm a little bit tired. But I have a sample here. Samples, PHP, and some. All right, so this is the script that I will be running. So I'm going to run a script, and it takes, it assigns 3 to the variable A, and it assigns 7 to variable B. And then I will echo some colon, and then close those, and then append or concatenate A, which is 3, and then plus 7. So anyone who wasn't at Derek's talk knows what the output of this will be? So the output will be 7. And that's because it does this operation first. So it does the concatenate sum and 3, and then it does the plus, and it converts that sum into a number. It doesn't find any number because it starts with an S, so it's just 7. So it converts it to a 0, and then it's 0 plus 7. Kind of a weird output, so they added a new warning. So if you're trying to use those operators in the same operation, it'll give you a warning now. So I wanted to see if that was true, because I didn't trust Derek. good thing he's not here, or I think he's not here. So one thing I did was to actually run this tool with, and I'll run it with, you'll see right here at the top. So I'll run it with PHP 7.1. And we can see that it gives me, it gives me a warning, non-numeric value, and I have the output 7. But what I wanted to see is, well, what do I get if I run it with PHP 7.4.3? And in this case, well, I'm getting the deprecated warning saying that it won't work starting at PHP 8. So that's a very interesting use case for Docker containers as well, because now I can actually test the same code in various different versions of PHP. So that was also a very mind-opening for or eye-opening thing for me. So now I can run different scripts and actually test them. So if you need to migrate something from PHP 5 to PHP 7 and you want to see how bad you will break everything, well, it's just a matter of using a different version of PHP inside your container. That tells you how long it's been since I've been doing PHP, right? Does anyone still migrate from 5 to 7? I do a little bit more JavaScript nowadays, so this is how you would run a Node Express server. So very similar. You know, you do a Docker run, you map a file on your file system, map the different ports, and you just specify which version of Node you want to use or which image of Node you want to use. And then you specify the command to run, so you'll actually need to do a Node and start your server. All right, so we've seen how that can somewhat help with the works on my machine syndrome. So now somebody, like if I had this new guy that just joined the team today, and he downloaded the new version of PHP, because 7.4.3 was released yesterday, well, he would get that warning message that I would not have gotten if I was running 7.1. So that's where it comes really useful. So you make sure that your application is always packaged and always shipped with the same version and the same environment, no matter who is using it. All right. So that solved one of my problems. I was able to run that script from that PHP application from my friend, but I was getting this weird error, something about file not found. So my friend was like, "Well, do you have the file ctemp log?" I was like, "Oh no, why? Hard-coded path, really?" So that's where environment variables will help you. So when you start using containers, you'll have to look into environment variables, and you'll want to isolate everything that is very specific to an environment into different environment variables. So it's really meant to store variables that will be specific to the environment, stuff like file names, ports, base URL. So in his case, he was using a Windows machine for development, so he needed to specify C:\, whatever it is. And because I'm using a Unix-based system, I had a different start folder or base folder. So you will specify those inside your environment variables, and then it's just a matter of setting that environment variable, and the people will be able to run your container. So very useful for file names, for ports. You're most likely not going to use the same port that you're using in development that you're going to use in production. So chances are you'll be using 8080 in development, but port 80 on your production servers. Base URLs. Stuff like the APIs that you're going to hit, you might want to store those in an environment variable so that you can actually change the different APIs that you're, or the APIs that you're going to use, or the base path for your APIs. So in this case, I'll run my server again, but the API that I'm accessing, I want to access the one that runs on my machine. I don't want to access the production API, because I'm actually working on something on my machine. So you know, I can specify an environment variable, base URL, and I'll just give it the URL. In PHP, in order to access those environment variables, it's just a matter of using the $_env, and you have access to that base URL that was passed in that command line. In Node.js, very similar, process.env gives you access to the environment variable, as you might be able to see there. All right. I'm getting lazy. I have a script somewhere. All right, so you can see here that the first Docker run had no -e argument in here. So it only outputted, you know, no name provided. So my script was looking for an environment variable, couldn't find anything. So outputted no name provided. But the second time I ran it, it had the -e, and name equals Joel in this case. And then the output of my PHP script was hello Joel. So you can really pass information into your containers by using environment variables. When you'll start using different containers and you'll start from base images, you might have to pass environment variables to your images as well. If you want to run MySQL, you'll need to specify a bunch of different environment variables so that MySQL knows how to configure itself. You'll want to give it the root password. You probably won't want to use root. You'll need to specify a default user and a default password as well. So you can specify all of those as part of the environment variables. Then you specify your ports and the image, once again. So you just specify, well, MySQL, and you give it a version in this case. So I'm going to run a MySQL server. And also another interesting thing, if we're gonna take a look at the running a MySQL database, is that you can actually specify an initial set of data that you want to inject into your database. And a lot of images will have, or base images will have something similar to this. So they'll have some sort of entry point, oftentimes called Docker entry point or some flavor of that. But whatever you put in there will be executed by the image as it starts. So in the case of MySQL, it will actually look into the Docker entry point in a DB folder, and it will apply any SQL files that are in there, and it will actually execute any script files or .sh files that are in this folder. So if we run, so now I've started my MySQL server. So once again, no installation necessary. So this just this very simple command. Well, actually, it's not that simple. It's a little bit. So that's why I'm getting lazy and I don't type them anymore. But that's the Docker command that I've executed. And that's it. My MySQL server is started. And here's a fun thing that we can do. So we can now run commands inside our container. So I can do an exec. And I'll run this in interactive mode. And it's called my MySQL. And I'll run a /bin/bash. So by doing so, I'm actually doing a shell inside my Docker container. So right now, I'm accessing, or I'm inside my Docker container that runs my MySQL. So I can do MySQL -u root -b root. And I'm inside my MySQL database. And from here, I can do different things like show databases. And there's nothing, so it's just the plain vanilla install of MySQL at this point. But really, that's all you need to start a MySQL server. Is it quit or exit? Exit. All right, and now I'm back into my operating system. Good. One thing that I can do, and I've already mentioned it, but I can do, no, I can do a Docker. I'll stop this one. In it. So I can use that initialization database, and now I've started my MySQL server again. And if I log into my machine, better. Databases. And now you can see that I have this table or this new database presentation, and I can use presentation, and I can't remember what's the name, from conferences? There it is. So I actually have an initial data set that was injected in my MySQL database. So once again, it was very, very fast. It started everything, no configuration necessary. The only thing that I need to do here was to actually say, well, this is my initial data set that you're going to use. Please set that as part of your setup. All right, but there's more than just a CLI to MySQL. And using those commands, there's a lot of things to remember. I've shown you a lot of commands, and even at the end, I don't even remember them. So that's why I have those script files that I just typed in. But so you can use, there's a bunch of different cheat sheets. I'll share some on Twitter afterwards. But one thing that you might want to also do is to use a Docker file. So Docker file will let you use pretty much the same options as you would inside the command line. And there's a standardized set of command, and it lets you pretty much build your own images for sharing. So you'll be able to create base images if you want that will have all of your specific environment variables and all the specific setup that you need for your specific use case. But you'll also be able to do stuff like copy all of your code inside that container. And then you'll be able to share that full container containing both your code, your source code, and the, all the necessary tools, and share all of that with your QA team, for example. So it builds a bunch of different stacks that can be shared. So Dockerfile will look a little bit like this for a PHP project. So you will start from a base image. So you will always, always start from a base image. So we'll use PHP 7.1 Apache in this case. You specify which port is used inside the container, so you will expose that port. That expose in this case is already specified in the PHP 7.1 image, so it's not necessary. But yeah, it's there for why not. And then you copy stuff from your local folder, from your local file system, and you copy all of that inside the container. So instead of mounting a volume like I did in the previous example, in this case, I'm actually copying all the source code into the container. So if I change anything on my file system, I won't see it in my Docker image. For Node.js, very similar. So you'll start from Node. You'll expose a different port that you want to use. You will copy all of your files. You'll specify a working directory in this case. And then you can run your npm install and do an npm start. The reason why I wanted to talk about the Node.js here is that the order in which you do the commands actually has an impact. So it will create a first image based on Node 10 in this case. And that will create a cache, and it will create one layer to give it a name. It will give it a hash. And it will always try to reuse that same cached image whenever it can. The next thing it will do, it will expose port 3000. That works. And then it will copy all of your source code. But as soon as you copy all of your source code, chances are it changed since the last time you've built it, or else there's no point in building a Docker image at this point. So by doing this here, it will create a new cache layer, and all the subsequent layers will have a different hash. So you won't be able to reuse that from the cache. So what you could do is change the order a little bit and start with your from node, expose the port, then copy your package.json, which is similar to a composer JSON file, specify the working directory. So far up until here, if your project is relatively, it's been a while since you worked on it, chances are you won't change your dependencies very often. So this is probably all the same. Running the npm install will install all the different dependencies specifying package.json. So this one can also still be cached. So up until there, it's all using cache, and it's much, much quicker. And then you copy your source file, and that one will change. And you'll be able to run those. You'll only have to do those two operations as part of your Docker build. So to build your Docker image, it's basically a way to compile your own images. You'll use Docker build and the path to your Docker file. It will look for a file named Docker file, so literally a Docker file, inside the current folder by default. If it's not, you'll have to specify where it is. So Docker build dot for a current folder. You'll probably also want to give them a tag, so you'll be able to find those images after a while. So you will just give it the name of your image and then a version number. Very important to give it a version number, or else it will just tag it latest, but you won't be able to find that image, so it's nice to actually tag them. Just a quick warning, your containers might be running as root. Not all systems will let you execute containers that are running as root. So if you're using some Kubernetes distribution, it'll give you errors. So you might want to change the user and do a bunch of things. There's an article at the end that kind of explained that. But it's just something that is good to know. So if you see error messages about being a root user, that might be what is going on. So Docker build lets you create a full custom image. And those images can be shared on registries. And the image is ready to share with the team or to deploy somewhere. In order to share those images, you will use public or private registries, which are pretty much the equivalent to GitHub. So Docker Hub is one of them. So you can use it in the same way that you would for GitHub. So you can put some registries, some private and some public. You can use Quay. Quay is an open source registry that you can install in your own infrastructure. And pretty much all the major cloud providers have their own registries that you're using that you can use. So if everything that you do is on the Google Cloud, then it makes sense to use Google Cloud's registries just for connectivity reasons. To publish your image, just do a Docker push, and you give it the name of your image. You will want to specify the name of the registry. When you're using Docker, it's docker.io by default. So if you're pushing to Docker Hub, no need to specify that. You need to specify your username and then the name of your container. So if I want to push my my PHP image, I'll just do docker push docker.io joel.lord/my-php-image. If you want to download an image, if you want to look at the code or an image that one of your colleagues published, then you can just do a docker pull, do the pretty much the same operation. It will download the image, and then you'll be able to run it. There's a few other interesting commands that you can do. Docker PS will list all the running containers. So I've did it a little bit earlier just to see the name of my container. Docker PS dash A will list all the containers, so even if they're not running right now. So that's where you'll see all the junk that you've installed and that you'll want to remove at some point. Docker stop will stop a container from running. So you can give it either the identifier that it got or the name that you specified. And Docker RM will actually remove that image. And if you need to rename a container for some reason, then you can use the Docker tag. All right. So it's all nice in theory. But one of the things that I found when I started using containers is that they just never did what I wanted. So there's a few things that you can use to help you kind of debug and try to figure out what's going on. Docker logs is a very useful command. So it will show you what is going on inside your container. So everything that you output in there, or the standard out, the STD out will actually be outputted there. So if you do Docker logs, my PHP actually, let's see, do I still have a PHP running, so I can do Docker logs, and we'll use dash F to follow it, and let's call my PHP. And now I have the logs of my Apache server in real time. So if I curl localhost 8080, you will see that there's a new entry that just appeared right here. So you can see the logs in real time, and you can kind of figure out what's going on. It might help you to, if you have permission issue or some weird errors that you can't figure out. Dash F to see them in real time. You can also execute commands inside your container. So you could do things like let's use ls and see what is inside my /var/ww/html folder inside my container, inside the container named myphp. Keep in mind that the command that you will execute, in this case, is /bin/ls. That's because the container is actually a Linux container. So you can't use dir as you would in Windows. You have to use the Linux equivalent. And you can also log into your container. So I've shown you that in the MySQL example. So just use an interactive command in this case. And then you just specify /bin/bash, and it will log you inside the container. And then from there, you can actually poke around the system, see what's going on. So that can be very useful for debugging purposes as well. You can also copy files to and from your container. So Docker CP will help you with that. So just specify the name of the image and then the path to the file in order to copy from your container inside your local file system. So Docker copy from MyPHP, and you can download the Apache configuration file, for example, if you're trying to figure out why your Apache is not working as you're expecting. And then you can copy from your local file system into the container by using the opposite. So you can, maybe you want to tweak a little bit your Apache or some configuration file, and then copy that back inside your container and see how it now behaves. So Docker logs, Docker exec, Docker CP are all tools that can be very useful when you have to debug or when something is not quite working. As you do more and more, it'll get easier, and you'll see that you probably don't need them as much. But at the beginning, those were tools that I really needed. Now, if you have multiple containers that you want to run, and I've told you the example I've joined in earlier, where they have the whole PHP application, and they also have a MySQL database, then you'll probably want to look into Docker Compose. Docker Compose is a tool that will let you run and start a bunch of different containers and take care of all the networking for all of them so that they can actually talk to each other. It'll use YAML files to describe all the containers. So you'll specify the version of Docker Compose, version 3 in this case, and you can specify various services that will run. In this example, I'm starting a database, and I'll start it from image MySQL 5.7. I'm not doing anything specific here. I should put all my environment variables here as part of my service. And then I have my web service as well, which is my PHP 7.1 Apache. And then I specified that it depends on DB. So now from there, I'll be able to access DB. And there's an internal DNS that will map DB into my MySQL database here. Once your YAML file is all set up, Docker Compose up, it'll just spin up all of your containers, and you're ready to go. So, should you use containers? Well, for your day-to-day development, definitely. I think it makes a lot of sense. It makes It makes it for more uniformity in your team or consistency inside your team. Everybody's running the same version, same type of thing. Or it also can be very useful if you need to test some code on different versions of PHP, for example. For testing, it makes a lot of sense because now you can package everything into a container and ship that to your QA team. And in theory, you know, there shouldn't be any more arguments on whether something happens on a machine or not. And for open source project, yes, 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 please do so. If you have an open source project and you're having trouble getting your contributors to actually help with your project, maybe it's a little bit too complicated. The door to entry maybe is a little bit too complicated, so that's definitely something that you should look into and try to Dockerize that application. If you need any help with Docker or with open source project that you want to Dockerize, I'd be more than happy to help you out. Just reach out on Twitter. So with this, that's all I had. There is more information available, pretty much all the links that I've shown. can't see anything. Easy URL to /containers. So you'll find the information there. And that's it. So thank you very much for attending.